Well, good morning and happy Thursday. We are in Hebrews chapter 9, looking at verse 27, and it's a passage that says it's appointed to a person once to die, and after that, to face judgment. So on Monday, I spoke a bit about the fact that we are going to die, and we tend to try not to think about that, but that there's some upsides to actually making peace with the fact that that we are going to die. That can actually be liberating to stare that down. And then on Tuesday, we shifted to thinking more about judgment, which is what really tends to be denied. There are many people who deny their death and think everybody's going to heaven. And I said, look, the reality is we're all gonna die, but not all of us go to heaven. And it's judgment that seems to be the particular stumbling block. So the first day we looked at Matthew 7:1, and I went after this idea that, you know, judge not lest you be judged. This is the verse many people know, and they say that, you know, judgment is non-Christian. And I said, no, that's not what that passage means. We have to take it in context. We have to use discernment, but we want to be gracious in how we judge other people. We tend to judge ourselves based on our intentions and other people based on their actions. And we need to be a little bit more rigorous than that. And we want to treat people the way we want to be treated. And then yesterday we looked at the idea that judgment is contrary to the gospel because we're saved by grace through faith, not of ourselves. There is no works involved there. And we said, well, yeah, that's true. We are saved on the basis of the work of Christ. We are saved on the basis of God's mercy extended to us. As many as received him, to them he gives the right to become children of God. So that's true, but that doesn't negate that we are held accountable for the lives that we live, for the things that we do or the things that we leave undone, for the things that we say or the things that we don't say, right? That half of the parables are about the radical nature of grace and the call to forgive. But half of the parables are about maximizing our lives and being up early and you know, not wasting our talents and all of that. So today I want to just speak to a third point ever so briefly, and that is, it's two points. The first thing I want you to know about judgment is that it comes at the end. So there are people who seem to be getting away with everything. And the psalmist in Psalm 73 says, when I considered the wicked, I envied them. I envied their lives. They're getting away with everything. I felt bad about myself. But he then works his way through and he realizes that that's not the end. And so there are people that seem to just be pushed down, and there are other people who seem to get away with everything. And so, look, judgment comes at the end. God doesn't settle accounts this side of eternity. There's a story told about a missionary couple that is retiring after 40 years of service, hard work. And they happen to be on the same plane as the Beatles, who are coming over to the U.S. for the first time. And the Beatles manager had famously, given out all this free stuff to have these huge fan base waiting for the Beatles when they got there. All these swooning young girls. And this missionary guy says to his wife the next day, he goes, I'm really a little bit offended that the Lord did not give us that kind of a homecoming. You know, the Beatles, this young mop-topped group of musicians get all these accolades and we get nothing. And his wife says, well, you better process that. And so he spends some time in prayer. And when he comes out, his wife says, so, you know, what did you hear from the Lord? And he says, I'm fine. The Lord reminded me, I'm not home yet. So God will settle his accounts in the end. And the last thing I want to say here is that our judgment will be fair. We don't fear an unfair judgment. We don't have to fear, you know, bad luck in this. There was a Gary Larson Far Side cartoon years ago that showed this guy standing at the pearly gates. There's Peter, you know, the big beard, and he's figuring out who gets in and who gets out. And Peter says to this guy, okay, it almost checks out. You just got one more question to answer. And then he says, a train leaves St. Louis going 30 miles an hour. Right? So it's going to be a math story problem. And this guy's horrified. Oh, no. Yeah, that's not the way it works. You're not going to have to know the, you know, Old Testament books in order or the names of all 12 apostles or something like that. No, it's actually, we get judged on the basis of our lives, the sum total of who we are and what we've done. And it's the things that we've done and the things that we've left undone. And you don't have to fear an unfair judgment. No, it's a perfect judgment. That's what we fear. And that's why we so desperately, if we're self-aware, why we so desperately want the mercy and grace of God. But we also want to be good stewards of our life and the things that we've been given. And so I don't try to, as a general rule, try to scare people into, you know, walking the right path. It honestly doesn't work for very long. And I'm just being lazy. I'm not going to try and use guilt to motivate you on an ongoing basis. But I never want to lessen the punch of a passage. We're told in Hebrews 9:27, it is appointed to you to die. You have an appointment with death. I do as well. And after that, we will face God and we'll be accountable for our lives. Let that shape how you live, how you love, how you serve today. See you tomorrow.